second edition of the PCEC's Words and Music programme. This morning we'll be welcoming back Barry Upton, a musician, a music producer, a music arranger, songwriter, performer, nightclub DJ, radio and TV presenter. That's a mouthful. What a resume. Barry will take us on a magical music tour of his latest album and video project, Life's a Beach. I said beach, okay? All 19 songs on the album reflect Barry's character and wicked sense of humour. Barry's an entertainer and live musician, has over 30 years top-line experience, including touring Europe with his own band, enjoying a nightclub band residency, performing as a frontline member of the group, the Brotherhood of Man. So please welcome, once again, Barry Upton.
Okay, let's just set this up. We don't have a Rosie today. Is that one on? Seen you before. Hands up all those who haven't seen you before, and hands up all those who couldn't give a damn if they ever saw me again. Always good to sort of get that one clear. I haven't had a chance to tune up yet, so let's just do that. Always a good thing to do. Should be pretty much in tune. I was playing last night at the Dusitani for 600 golfers. There again tonight for the presentation night. There should be 1,000 there tonight. So I thought what I'd do is start off by doing something nice and positive and sunshiny. And I think some of you might have heard my Beatles talk about the Beatles. And I'm a big fan of the Beatles, so I'm going to kick off with this little Beatles classic. It's alright. Little darling, it's been a long, cold, lonely winter. Little darling, it feels like years since it's been here. Here comes the sun. Here comes the sun, and I say it's alright. Little darling, the smile's returning to the faces. Little darling, it feels like years since it's been here. Here comes the sun. Here comes the sun, and I say, it's alright. Now you can join in on this bit. I'll show you how the words.
Sun, 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 here it comes.
Everybody.
Sun, 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 here it comes.
Get louder.
Here comes the sun, I say, It's alright. It's alright.
Move over to here. Okay, so I think quite a few of you know of me as the radio DJ and TV presenter, but not many people know what I did before that, before I came to Pattaya, because I didn't really do it. TV presenting. I did a little bit of radio back in the UK, but mainly I've been in the, I like how it said 30 years in the music business, but it's actually 42 as a professional, so yeah, I'm a bit older. I think that was probably written before I came to Pattaya. So what I thought I'd do is give you a quick overview of what I've done since I became a professional at the age of 21. And hang on. Yeah. Wait for the cue. Starting back from the beginning if you could. That'd be great. Okay, so first of all, I was in a band, which my own band, which we toured all around Europe and working 7 nights a week, doing the real long, hard slogs, and there was a club in Copenhagen where there was two bands on the night, and you played 4 45-minute sets, and then the next band would come on and do 4 45-minute sets. So there were two bands every week for a month's contract, but we kept renewing our contracts. We were having such a great time. And what happened was that one month the band were going to be a week late. So, he knows this club very, very well in Copenhagen. And they were going to be a week late, so what were we going to do, the management said. So we said, well, if we can have their money, we'll do their spots. So we ended up doing 8 hours playing a night, well, with breaks, a few breaks. And all we did was sleep and play that whole week. And after that, I remember thinking, everything else I do in my life is going to be a lot easier than this. So it's going to seem easier, and that's exactly what happened, really. But it's great to get that work ethic into yourself. And that culminated in me joining a mecca band, which is like a resident band in the nightclub, and working on writing songs. So what happened then was that I ended up, you know how sometimes you create your own luck? People say, oh, you were lucky. But no, you create your own luck. I happened to be in a studio in London, and in the next studio to it, studio one, studio two, the big studio, I was in a small one, there would be people like The Who, there was Kate Bush, Thomas Dolby, big acts like The Hollies, and then one day, Brotherhood of Man. So I happened to be, I was trying to say hello to these people, meet these people, and it was always a thrill to think, you know, we're in the same studio. So Brothers of Man were there one day. Well, little did I know that one of the members wanted to leave because he had a family and they were constantly touring. They had 3 number one hits. And I walked in and they suddenly went, God, he looks a little bit like the guy who wants to leave. So then they checked me out, playing live and whatever, and next minute I was offered the job. So it was a little bit of a stroke of luck, but it was a massive leap up in the music business. And from that moment on, I was in top studios, learning production and working with top musicians, and it was great. I learned my trade that way. So that after the Brotherhood of Man thing ended in the mid-80s, I was able to go on and produce all kinds of music, and I was producing people like Frankie Vaughan, the Nolans, and acts that I used to buy records from, and that was one of the biggest thrills. Like, for instance, has anybody heard of the Baron Knights? Right, well, the Baronites, when I was a kid, I used to buy their records, I thought they were hilarious. And then their manager became my agent at one point, and bit by bit I got to know them. Next minute, I'm producing them. So I was in the studio with them for a week, and that's one of the greatest productions I've ever done. I've really thoroughly enjoyed everything on that. Then I started having a few small hits. I hit the Brother the Man and a few dance hits. And I used to go to a place called Medem, the Medem Trade Fair in Cannes, in France. And it was every January. Good place to sort of hand out all your latest productions, and very often you'd come away with some kind of deal. Well, at one of these, I was standing in the line for checkout, or check-in, I should say, to come back to the UK. And I was chatting to somebody, as you do. It's all music industry people there. And this guy turned around and said, "Oh, are you Barry Upton?" I says, "Yes." He said, "I've got one of your cassettes with some songs, and there's a couple on there that I really like. One of them is the remix of the Nolan Summer Move for Dancing, or remake of it." And I said, "Oh, yeah, what's your name?" He said, "Simon Cowell." Never heard of him. So anyway, he said, at that point, he wasn't that well known, you know? So he asked me to go into his office and said, "I'd like to sign a couple of these tracks. They're really good, dance tracks." So I went in there with my ex-manager for Brotherhood of Man, who knows the business really well and knew Simon very well. And I walked out of there with a writing deal as a writer for his company, and enough money to go and buy my own recording studio. So I've got a lot to thank Simon Cowell for. Within a year, I had a hit record with him, which was Sonia, and a song called Only Fools Never Fall in Love. And then, of course, he went on to massive heights. So I mean, I came across him a few more times after that. And we were always good friends, and I always have to respect him for that massive leap he did for me. So then I was producing, I had hits with Lindy Layton and a Chelsea Football Club. I know, how does that happen? And then I was producing all this kind of stuff. And then in the early 90s, I was DJing in nightclubs, but dance music was becoming very, very boring. You know, in the late 80s, dance music was great, it was very tuneful. But all of a sudden, all this boom chip, boom chip, boom chip, boom chip stuff came in, you know, with no tune whatsoever. I thought, "Oh, no, that's not for me." So I turned to country music, which I've always liked. I loved bands like the Eagles. And at that time, in the early 90s, a lot of influences like soul, rock, and just all amalgamated into country music. I'm sure there's many of you that are into country music would never know what I'm talking about. So I started going to America and Nashville and researching it and started playing this music, which culminated me in picking up on the line dance phenomenon that was happening in America, and it was just starting to happen in the UK. So I ended up producing records in Nashville, writing with some great writers, meeting a lot of the big country stars. And so I was trying to think, how can I make this big in the UK? And then it suddenly dawned on me one day, I saw some kids dancing to doing a line dance to a pop record. So I thought, that's it, it's got to be a pop group that they can understand. They don't understand Hats and Boots and Yeehaw and all that stuff. So I started thinking about how I could put together an act that would be, you know, palatable to kids. So then one day I was at a songwriting kind of like a showcase, and it suddenly popped into my head that they always count dances in line, or any dance, any choreographed dance. They don't count it in 1, 2, 3, 4 like musicians do. They always count 5, 6, 7, 8. And that was my eureka moment, because I really wrote a song called 5, 6, 7, 8, which went on to become a worldwide hit. Including, any Australians here? Number one in Australia. It was 16 weeks in the UK charts, 4 months, all over Christmas. In fact, we're celebrating this year 20 years since that happened. And the group that I put together to actually do this song are now out on tour. They're doing a big arena tour of the UK and celebrating 20 years since it first came together. So very proud of that. They became a really big act. And the song is a big party song, so it's all these party compilations and stuff every year, you know, which is always nice for a bit of royalties. So 5, 6, 7, 8 was a big turning point for me. And that made, that was probably my biggest hit. But then, of course, after that, then people come to you and ask you, can you produce this, can you produce that? And I ended up producing another friend of mine who was, who wasn't a friend up to that point, but I'd always gone to go and see him at live, a guy called John Otway. And he's hilarious. I always thought he was just such a character on stage, you couldn't possibly copy what he did. And then we got talking one day, and he said, oh, you've had hit records, why don't you? I need to have another hit. I haven't had one since 1977. So I thought, well, you know, we'll have a go. That culminated in a top 10 hit, and it was amazing to actually have someone who you admired so much and you could put them back into the top 10. So that was a big moment for me as well. Then there was an act called the Cheeky Girls, which were thought of as not being that good, but I thought they were brilliant because they were so entertaining. And I ended up having a couple of hits with them as well. And at that time, I had a friend, an actor in England called Shane Ritchie, and he labelled me a pop tart. I said, "What do you mean a pop tart?" He says, "Well, you're just like a musical prostitute. You know, people call you up, and you don't care, do you? You don't care about the music or whatever. You know, as long as it's a hit." And I always thought, "Yeah, actually, I'd rather have a hit, be in the charts, than out of it." So, musical sort of, you know. The style of the music didn't really matter too much to me. So then I had a Christmas hit with the girls in my band, my live band. They said, "Why don't you write a Christmas song?" And I was thought, that's a little bit too schmaltzy or something, you know. Unless it's funny. So I ended up coming up with the line, "I'd like to give you one for Christmas," which then became a top 5 hit. So. I was quite happy about that one. And I'm sure it's going to be played back in the UK this Christmas on the video channels. And after that, we're talking about now the mid-2000s, and the company that put out that Christmas record, they then asked me to do a couple of songs for a World Cup album they were doing. They couldn't license the original tracks, so could I copy them? And I did, and that went on to sell like hotcakes. Which then got me a 5-album contract with this company and Gut Records. And we did a Grease party album, we did a Halloween album, a party album, which is still sells to this very day. Every Halloween, it very often. Goes to number 1 in the children's iTunes chart. This year, it actually went to number 1 in the iTunes general chart. So that was an amazing one to have. We did a My Favorite TV Themes. This were aimed really at kids, and it was TV advertised. So all of these things were, you know, when bands were suddenly finding it very difficult to get a recording contract, I had this amazing deal because they were doing TV advertising every album. We did 2 lots of My Favorite Musicals, and then I decided it was time to leave the UK and come to somewhere where it was nice and sunny. Originally it was going to be San Diego in America, because I used to go to America a lot. And then I was doing a lot of shows out in Dubai and Bahrain. And then I eventually came into Southeast Asia. I thought, this is the place for me. I love it. So moved over here. Kind of curtailed the production a little bit, because as soon as I came over here, I was put on the radio as a guest, really. And then the radio manager said, "Have you done radio before?" And I said, "Well, a little bit." He says, "We need you here." So, and that was it. So we walked into a job. So there goes retirement. And 7 years I've been doing radio for patio people and TV presentation, and then also production as well, so I went into TV production. All interesting, all fascinating. You know how it is, you need something to do when you're here, really. So it was a reason to get up every morning, and get up, do the morning breakfast show. Great fun. And then, during that time, I had various guests on the programme, and one guest was a guy who'd been been the subject of a couple of documentaries for Sky TV in England, because he had a ladyboy girlfriend and a ladyboy bar. And when he came on the show, I thought he was hilarious. He was a really nice guy, and we became friends. And I went down to his bar, and I was looking at all these ladyboys one day, as you do. I'm sure there's plenty of you that have done that. And I was looking at them thinking, God, they're so entertaining. Wouldn't it be funny if there was a band, a ladyboy band? So he contacted the Sky producers, and they came out like a shot. They said, what a great idea. And the guy that put Steps together, the band Steps together, puts a ladyboy band together. So we did a three-part documentary, which resulted in appearing live on Nationwide Thai TV, and an album. So there you go, there's the album there. So that was a very unusual thing to do, and I couldn't see that one coming. Then I wrote a song for Patia, because I kept hearing that song, you know. I wasn't really that keen on it, so somebody said, well, will you write one? So I did a wrote a song called Patia Wonderland, which we did a big video for a TV program, actually. It was a massive film crew there in Walking Street, and I ended up playing that, and that became a bit of a hit around the area. And that brings me up to my latest project, which I'll talk about in a moment. So now, everything I've been talking about so far, we can see visually now. So here we go. Take it away. Thank you.